No problems.
You're quite kind of zoomed in, huh?
Yeah.
They're just getting it sorted. Yeah.
So you're ready?
Okay.
Sorry. Okay, we're ready now.
Multiple times, but this is your first time in 2 years. Would it be safe to say that you feel like this is a good return to form for you?
Yeah, definitely. It's a sense of familiarity. There's a sense of belonging. Definitely, you know, I've been, like you mentioned, I've been in the playoffs a bunch of times, so it's nice to be back. Also, kind of gets me focused on what I need to do moving forward. And it's a testament to, you know, having gotten through all the challenges and all the obstacles that I've had to face, I think, the last 18 months. So, yeah, it definitely gives me a sense of pride. But it's only the first step. You know, there's still a long ways to go in the playoffs, and I want to stay focused on what I need to do next.
Could you expand a little bit more on the challenges that you mentioned? Of course, we discussed this in brief, you know, before the Olympics.
Yeah.
You did have COVID and you did overcome it. But
yeah.
Could you just expand a little bit more? Because as you mentioned, this is has been a, you know, up and down 2 years for you.
Yeah, it's been a very challenging 2 years for me. As you know, I lost my full status 2 years ago, obviously, because I didn't make it to the playoffs. I had to go back and get my card back, which I was able to do. And then the 2019-20 season, I wasn't playing my best. And then obviously, COVID struck the whole world. I was in India for 4 months. I came to play the Indian Open. Eventually, that meant I couldn't play 4 or 5 events out here. So by the time I got back here, considering I hadn't played well early in that season, I couldn't keep my status. So it was back to, you know, being in a lower category. When I say category, basically that determines how many events you get, how many starts you get, how many opportunities you get. So I had very limited opportunities, even at the beginning of this season. So I actually did really well to take advantage of those opportunities. And then, like you just mentioned, I got a bad case of COVID earlier in the year that knocked me out, not just out of events, but also physically and you know, competitively, took me out for almost 2 months, I would say. So to have to deal with all of that, come back out, and, you know, of course, the Olympics, which was a blessing, was not something I was expecting. We just talked about how I haven't played my best in the last 2 years, so to have that opportunity at Tokyo was a huge positive. But that also meant that I couldn't play maybe 2 events that I would have otherwise played. So, you know, I had to really push myself hard physically and you know, mentally, to make sure that I got myself here. And it's been a challenge, which, you know, I've responded really well to. So it's given me a lot of confidence, it's given me a lot of encouragement, you know, to start moving back in the direction in which I want to go, in which, you know, I know how good I can play. So all those things combined, I would say it's been a roller coaster year that has kind of led me to this spot. So now I'm just trying to look forward and not behind.
I think it was this week when you also registered your best finish in the in a major.
Yeah, I was.
I was
looking at one of those throwback to, and you know, you're getting old when you're on a throwback to image. But yes, you're right. That was a while ago. It was 6 years ago at Whistling Straits. One of my better events of my career. Very memorable, but. Yeah, you know, when you see those things, you kind of know what you can do, and that also helps you to refocus and believe in your own self.
So that was exactly my point, that, you know, maybe that can also serve as some sort of inspiration. How do you feel going into the playoffs? Your best finish was the 51st. Obviously, the aim would be to go even further than that.
Absolutely.
After the final event. How confident do you feel, and what do you make of your, you know, just form right now?
Well, the good thing is I'm playing well. I think that's the one thing that you need to know and believe going into the playoffs. You know, you can have a really good year and come into the playoffs not playing your best. And a lot of times, you know, you build momentum going into the playoffs. If you look at my season, you know, I've had a couple of my better finishes in the last 60 days. I feel like I'm playing well. Even when I feel like I've played poorly, I've still, you know, managed to hang in there and play 4 days and stay with the group. So definitely that's a huge positive, you know, going into the playoffs, feeling like I'm playing well. Coming back to Liberty National, the last time I played was the President's Cup in 17. And, you know, I have a lot of good memories from that week as well. So, you know, having said all of that, you know, there's a lot of things that are good. But at the end of the day, when I tee it up day after tomorrow, you know, I need to have my A game. This is one of the best fields in golf, if not the best fields outside of the majors. So I know that I'm going to have to go out and play my best. But I know that if I do, I will get deeper in the playoffs.
Finally, I just want to ask you, we've seen the aftermath of the Olympics in India, also what Aditi managed to do for Indian golf, you know, getting people excited.
Absolutely.
Anytime any of you guys do well, and of course you've been on the PGA Tour, you're now in the FedEx playoffs, you know, when our athletes do well, they bring the focus back onto the sport. Just a thought on, you know, how the conversation was back around golf with the Olympics and certainly with you making the playoffs again.
Yeah, I think this was actually one of the conversations I had with the journalist when I was in Tokyo. And it was about, you know, people like Aditi, Shubhankar, Gaganjeet, myself, you know, the four or five golfers who've been, you know, playing internationally on the higher levels. I think it's our responsibility, all of us collectively, to keep doing well consistently. You know, Aditi obviously played brilliantly at Tokyo, and we saw the huge, you know, difference it made in terms of visibility for golf. You know, if I go out and I play really well in the playoffs, that'll be another kind of boost. And then, you know, if Shubhankar does the same thing in 2 or 3 weeks at a big European Tour event, that'll be the same thing. I think the problem is when none of us do anything significant for 6, 8, 9 months, is that the visibility goes down. It's like all of us, it's our collective responsibility to keep playing well. Between the 4, 5, 6 of us, if we keep doing well, then the focus keeps, the spotlight keeps coming back to golf. And if it consistently keeps staying on golf, regardless of who it is or where it is or what event it is, that's when the sport starts growing. You don't want the sport to go out of the limelight for 12, 18 months and then it'll be like, oh, you know, nothing's really happened in the sport. Where the reality is that Aditi's been here for 5 years. I'm finishing up my 7th season on the PGA Tour. These are not easy things to do in any case. But the thing is, that's not going to be in the spotlight unless we win or unless we contend or unless we're in there on a Sunday and in the mix. And I think that's what all of us have to keep doing more consistently for the game to grow at the same consistency. Otherwise, you see one big spurt, and then it dies down and then nothing happens for a while. So I think that's what I feel personally all of us need to keep doing.
Well, all the best. Thanks a lot for talking to me. And you've got big 3 events coming up. All the very best for that.
Thanks, Shivani. Take care.
Take care.
Okay.
Wow. Thank you, Chua.
Hi, Chua.
Oh, still
recording. You don't need that part. Okay, so for the next one, we're doing your press conference.
Yes.
So what I'm going to do is go sit over there.
Can we shut that door?
Yes, absolutely.
It's kind of hard to shut, so as long as you get it like close to shut, we're good.
Hang on, let me put my back.
Put your strength into it. Wow. All right, I'm going to sit here, but you still need to look at that camera.
Sure, no worries.
But I'll tee up the first 2 questions and then...
No worries.
You know how it goes.
Yep.
They said the next one's Zoom, right?
The next one is the Teams link.
Teams.
It is, here I send it to you.
Okay, should I go ahead and join now?
Yes.
Okay.
I know most of these guys anyway, so it's...
Okay, great.
Pretty easy.
I don't need to be you, Bobby. Can you guys hear us? I hear them.
Someone's typing.
Chua?
Chua, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Great.
Go ahead. I can hear you.
Okay, you ready to start?
Yeah, take it away. I'll start the recording now.
Okay. You want me looking into that camera?
Yeah.
Yes, right, please.
You got it.
Yes.
Sorry, I forgot to tell you that one before we
It's all right. It's all right.
Okay, we are recording. Whenever y'all are ready, take it away, Chua.
All right. Honorbon, welcome to back to the playoffs. We're at the Northern Trust here. You've had an exciting journey to get to this place. Just talk about your excitement to be back playing in the FedEx Cup playoffs.
I'm thrilled. I'm delighted. You know, it's been a challenging year, and you know, I've had a few hurdles to jump over, and I'm happy that I find myself here. And you know, how far I go from here is the reins are back in my hand, and you know, I can actually, if I just play well, I can make it even better. So yeah, I'm really excited.
And before we open it up to the media, can you touch on your recent trip to Japan and the Olympics and how special that was for you?
It was fantastic. I mean, obviously, you know, being a second Olympics for me, I thought it was way better than my experience in Rio for many different reasons. I started better, but obviously disappointed with the way I played. To some extent, I feel like, you know, I kind of ran low on energy and something that I have to manage better if I ever get another opportunity. But you know, everything was brilliant. No regrets at all, and I'm so glad that I got to be a part of it. And you know, it's something that will always be close to my heart. Anytime I get to wear the tricolors, it's what I live for.
We'll go ahead and open up to questions. We'll start with Joy at Global Golf Post.
Hi, Ban.
How are you doing, Joy?
Can you hear me?
I can hear you, yes.
I'm good. Listen, Ban, can you just give us an understanding and an appreciation as to what maybe, you know, finishing 122nd in the FedEx Cup means as compared to maybe even first or second in the Korn Ferry Tour finals?
There's a very big difference, Joy. I know you understand a lot of it, but I'll answer it as briefly as I can. I think, you know, eligibility is a very, very big criteria on the PGA Tour. There's a lot of different kinds of status that you could have. Obviously, if you won a tournament, that's the ideal status because that guarantees you every start, more or less. And then, like I said, we're at the playoffs. The deeper you go into the playoffs, the better you finish on the FedEx Cup, the better your eligibility for next year. But if you do make it into the top 125, which is your question, you're almost guaranteed to play all the full field events. When I say full field events, it's barring the invitationals, which is Bay Hill, the Genesis, and Memorial, and also the CJ and the Zozo Cup, which are the other two short field events. So outside of these five events, you're pretty much guaranteed entry into every other event, including the Players' Championship, which is almost like a fifth major. Whereas, if you are, say, even third or fourth from the Korn Ferry, you know, category, which comes in two or three categories after 125, if you don't play well in the early part of the season, which would be September through end of November, you could find yourself in a situation where you may get, you know, 10 or 15 less starts compared to where you would be even if you were the last guy from the 125 category. So the biggest difference for me personally, having been in on the other side of the fence, is I can actually plan a schedule. I actually know that I'm going to be eligible and I will be able to enter a lot of the events. Whereas in the last couple of years, a lot of times you're waiting to see, am I going to enter? Is someone going to withdraw? Am I going to get an invite? That just helps you to plan your year better, plan your conditioning better, plan your fitness better, plan everything, you know, and it's a huge difference mentally in terms of your approach. You can also pick and choose which events you play and which ones you skip, you know, what golf courses fit you and what golf courses don't fit you, because that's not something in your hands if you're in the other category, because you're going to play whatever you get into. So it's a big deal.
Yeah, Thanks, Bal. I'll come back later.
Sure.
Swami? Next up?
Am I on?
Yes.
Hi, Anirban, Swami here.
Hi, Swams.
You know, of course, Joy asked the first question there. Was, I just want to know, as to, in terms of your physical fitness, you know, in terms of what the COVID took out of you and the slow recovery path, like, how closer are you to where you were before the, you know, the pandemic hit you? And the second part being, how much of a fall season would you be looking up to? Because, you know, in around 16, 17, 18, you always had a good start of the fall season, and then you kind of consistently built upon it.
Good question, Swami. I think it took me about 2 full months before I could start getting back closer to my normal speed and normal strength. So I would say by the end of June, I started feeling a lot better. But it just so happened with my category and with the schedule as it was this year, I played a lot of events in June and July. That was 1 week on, 1 week off, 1 week on, 1 week off. So it was really good for me in the sense that coming out of COVID, I was able to manage my energy levels really well. But going into the last part of the season, obviously, you know, there was no choice. I had to go for broke. I had to take every opportunity. So I played 4 weeks on the trot, starting with the Travelers Championship through to the Barbasol. And then I had maybe 4 days off before I left for Tokyo. Tokyo, as we all know, was extremely hot and humid, and it took a lot out of us. And then when I came back, I had another 4 days before I started last week. So I would have said that my conditioning was really good, but I think these last 45 days, playing 4 weeks, traveling, playing in Japan, coming back, is definitely taken some out of me. So I'd probably say I'm close to like 60 or 70%. So my main focus this last 2 weeks has been managing my energy, managing my workload, making sure that I'm getting enough practice and enough rest so that I'm still fresh for my tournaments. To answer the second part of your question, I think the fall will basically be directly dependent on how deep I go in the playoffs. You know, if I can get myself into BMW and maybe even into the Tour Championship, then I'll definitely play less in the fall. But if I don't go as deep as I would like to go, I'll probably have more time off between, you know, when this postseason finishes and when the next fall season starts. And accordingly, I'll, you know, play more or less. Also, the other thing is, depending on how deep I go in the playoffs, I'll know whether I get into Zozo and CJ, which are two of the shorter fields events. So, you know, there's still a little bit of permutations and combinations. But yes, I'm still looking to play at least 5 or 6 events in the fall. How deep is it going to go?
Have to ask the question.
Please. Sorry, Swami, could you repeat that question?
He wants to know where to go deep in a playoff.
Oh, so when I say going deep in a playoff, it basically refers to, you know, where you finish the postseason in terms of your FedEx Cup ranking. So say I've entered this week as 121.
When you said going deep.
Yeah. So what I meant is, like, for instance, I start this week as 121. But if I play myself into BMW, that obviously means I'm already in the top 70. And then depending on how I play in BMW, that number might change. So when I say going deep, it basically means how low can you get your FedEx number? Because if I'm inside the top, say, 50 or 60, then I'm going to get into all the invitationals, all the limited field events, and then suddenly my schedule looks different. But say I finish 115 or 110 or 100, I'm not guaranteed those other additional, or, you know, you could say bonus events. So then your schedule changes again, because you know that you're not going to get into those events. So depending on your final FedEx Cup number, you could be looking at an alternative schedule, even though you're fully exempt from the 125 category. That's what I meant.
We'll go to Alora from the Telegraph.
Laura, the laptop's running low on battery. It's only 12%.
Hello?
Yes.
Hi, Arirban. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you. Please go ahead.
Hi. Ilora from the Telegraph. Just wanted to know, you're back in the playoffs. So how excited are you? How you did mention that a bit in answer to Swami's question. But if you can just elaborate, how important are the playoffs and how excited are you to be back in the playoffs?
I'm thrilled, absolutely thrilled. I think the playoffs are basically, you know, the whole year we're grinding, we're doing our best. Obviously, we're trying to win. That's the main goal. But the second goal outside of that is to make sure you get into the playoffs. It basically means I get to have a job next year for sure. It basically gets to me, you know, it means that I get to improve on my year. You could have an average year and just about make it to the playoffs. And then if you play really well in these next 2 or 3 weeks, that could be the difference between an average year and, you know, one of the best years of your career. So basically these next 2 or 3 weeks are probably, after the majors, the most important weeks in the year for all of us who play on the PGA Tour, because it defines and determines what next year looks like, what opportunities you're going to have, and you know, where you would classify your year as a success or a mediocre year or a poor year. So yes, I think the playoffs is where it starts. So once you get into the playoffs, basically you're giving yourself the opportunity to be able to do that. So it's in your hands now. You know, how good a year or not, it turns out to be, kind of depends on how you play these next 2-3 weeks.
Right. Thank you, and best of luck.
Thank you.
Rohit, you can come on video and ask your question.
Hi, everyone.
Hi, Rohit. How are you?
I'm fine, man. So I am hearing about your excitement to play in the playoffs. Also, I want to know is, have you ever played at the Liberty National? Because it has a very storied past. It's a historic club. Have you ever played? And what has been, what is your idea about the club?
So I've only played here before in the President's Cup in 2017. And even though I have played here in that event, I think there's a big difference between playing this week and playing that week, primarily because that was a match play event. This is a stroke play event. The golf course was set up differently for match play. In fact, even the course routing was different. The first hole and the 18th hole was changed in 2017 so that it fit the match play format better. Now that we're playing the stroke play format, it's going to go back to the standard routing where, you know, 1 through 18 is going to be how the golf course was initially designed for stroke play. I haven't yet actually gone out and played, so I can't really tell you, you know, what the difference is in terms of the course conditions or the setup. The other difference is I'm here now in, you know, August as opposed to October or late September. I don't even remember exactly when it was. So the weather is different. It's a lot warmer now. When we played last time, it was a lot cooler. That also kind of changes how the golf course plays. So yeah, I've been here. I kind of know what to expect. I know what the golf course looks like. But again, this is going to be a you know, readjustment for me in a way, to refamiliarize myself with the layout of the golf course and more specifically with the conditions this week. And also the strategies. You know, your strategy changes when you're playing match play and when you're playing stroke play. It's completely different. But yeah, I have good memories. I had, you know, a very memorable day here 4 years ago. So there's definitely a good positive connection with the venue. And, you know, hopefully I can build more positive memories this time around.
Can I ask you another question?
Please.
You were cheering on Aditi Ashok during the Olympics, and she was on the verge of winning. And you also made, in your tweet, you made a comment about getting more public courses and more support, garnering more support for golf. Do you think this is the right time, the right moment, when obviously she has been a trailblazer for golf, Indian golf, especially women's golf, and you have have been flying the flag high in the President's Cup and in the World Cups also you have represented India. So many number of tournaments you have represented India.
I don't think there's ever a bad time, Rohit. You know, the whole conversation about public courses and public driving ranges, it's been going on now for easily over a decade. I've been a pro myself now for, 14 years, starting my 15th year now. And really, we haven't seen any more ranges or public courses that have come up. I understand, you know, there are a lot of other challenges. There are a lot of, there's a lot of premium to real estate and what we need to use it for. We have a lot of other challenges in our country and I'm totally respectful of that. But it doesn't take a lot to have a small driving range. Liberty National itself, if you look at the history, was built on what used to be a garbage dump, right? And we have another couple of golf courses in America where we've had PGA Tour events which has a similar history. So what's stopping us from maybe doing that? You know, there is a lot of scope for us to be able to take, you know, waste areas or areas that are not really going to be of prime usage and convert it into something that can be constructive and meaningful for sport in general. And golf is one of those sports. So, you know, the fact that there were so many eyeballs on golf, thanks to Aditi, the way she played, the fact that a lot of people were talking about it and a lot of politicians and government officials were, you know, congratulating and raving about it, which I'm so glad to see. I'd love to see some action being taken towards having, you know, more of us, more Aditis and more Udayans and other people who could go ahead in, you know, the future Olympics and do something meaningful for the country. We all know what a medal at the Olympics means to our country, but we also need to be able to develop on a grassroots level. You and I can't do as much at the grassroots level as the authorities can. So, you know, my tweet and my plea was more to do with that because there are opportunities. You don't have to make 400 acres sprawling luxury golf courses, but you could make three small ranges, you know, in areas that we have land that's not going to be used for something else. That nobody is stopping us from doing that, but somebody needs to take the initiative. That was what my plea was more about, because that's where, you know, you're going to find the diamonds in the rough. That's where you're going to find the talent. You're not going to find it if there's nowhere for someone to go and even get introduced to the sport. So that's how I passionately feel about it, because I want to grow the sport. I want people to play the game. And I also want to change the perception. You know, this whole perception that it's a rich man's sport, it's an elitist sport. It needs to go away, but it won't go away unless somebody can pay 100 rupees and go and learn how to play golf. You know, and that's not going to happen unless you have a public driving range or a public course or access. So, you know, it's like a cycle. It can either be a vicious cycle or it can be a constructive cycle, and it's about changing that.
Thank you. Thank you. We'll
do two last questions. First is Chua.
Hey, Bon, just wanted to ask, with your position now in the FedEx Cup playoffs, where you're sitting and with top 70 getting into BMW, do you sort of like change how you approach this week, knowing whether you need to be aggressive? And secondly, just a follow-up to Rohit's question about being at Liberty National, where you had that President's Cup experience, with Quail Hollow being less than a year away, is that also on the horizon for you?
Yeah, I think, you know, at the end of the day, I've been in this situation so many times, you know, in my career. And what I've found over the years is you just focus on what you need to do. You know, you focus on hitting fairways, you focus on hitting it close, you focus on making those putts. You really focus on making as many birdies and minimizing your mistakes. I know it sounds like a broken record, but really that's what you have to do. You know, any changes in strategy are only going to come in, you know, on a Saturday or a Sunday. If you are able to do what I just said well, only then can you find yourself in a position where there is a, you know, there is a need or there is a benefit in changing your strategy. You know, even at the Olympics, it was the same thing. It's like, oh, you know you're going to need to medal. You need a top three. But would any of us have played differently on a Thursday or Friday? I don't think so. You know, the idea is to work yourself into a position where you get to a Saturday back nine or a Sunday where you now know, okay, I'm, you know, four shots behind medal position, so I need to shoot 8 under today, or I'm in medal position, I need to minimize mistakes and do this. But nothing really changes till you can get yourself in that position. So even though I know what I need to do to get to the next event, I don't think it's going to alter how I go about my golf. Because only if I play that way am I going to maximize my chances to play my best. And at the end of the day, it's only if I play my best that I'm going to keep moving forward. So that's got to be the mentality. As far as the President's Cup is concerned, you said it's a year away. And, you know, it's so good to see so many of the internationals playing phenomenally well. You know, whether it's Abraham Ancer, Scotty played well last week, Gracie played well. You know, there's a lot of us who are doing really well. So, you know, it's going to be a nice... stiff challenge to get into the team. So I know I have to consistently keep playing well. And again, it goes back to what I just said. You just keep doing what you're supposed to do and the results take care of itself.
Thank you.
All right, last question from Joy.
Hey, Brian. Okay, just two small questions and it depends on how long you want to answer it.
So balls in my court, I see. Okay.
Big balls. Okay, listen, number one is that sixth year on the PGA Tour, and I don't think people, at least back home, appreciate what you have managed to do. But what does it tell you about yourself that 6 years on this, you know, trot on the PGA Tour, even without winning once, it's difficult and you've managed to do it. What does it say about yourself? And the number two question that I have is driving. How well you are driving the golf ball and what has really happened in this last 1 year that has made that change? I mean, you're driving phenomenally well at the moment.
I'll answer your first question. I think what that tells me is that I need to win. It's been too long. And also, I consider this as my seventh year because the 1 year before I was fully exempt, I still played 12 times. And I still almost kept my card. So I feel like I've been here 7 years or seven seasons. It's a big positive for me, the fact that I've kind of not played my best. I've not even been close to my best. I know that. But I've still managed to, keep myself here and keep giving myself the opportunities. And going back to like how I started, the answer is like I really need to win. You know, I really need to get that off my chest. I need to get that, albatross off my shoulders, cross off my neck in a way. But I also feel like, you know, I've been through so many cycles, so many ups and downs and ups and downs and challenges physically, challenges mentally, emotionally. Being away from home, beginning to make this tour and this place my home, a lot has happened. So to that extent, I feel like I'm in a good place right now with my game and with everything else. So hopefully this next season, call it my seventh or my eighth, will be the season where I finally get my first win. And as far as my driving is concerned, I think it's been a combination of equipment change that has made a huge difference. I went free agent last year, which basically means I don't have an equipment contract with any one company. I think that's really allowed me to play the best 14 clubs that I could play for myself. That's definitely helped me a lot. I think some of my shortcomings was because of contractual obligations that was inhibiting me. And also the fact that I've, started working again, more specifically on my fitness, trying to get stronger, also working on my biomechanics with my trainer here, Ken McDonald, who's really helped me get faster as well, but more than faster, get more efficient, which is why, you know, I might not have 120 miles of club speed, but I'm still able to get the ball out there, well over 300 yards when I need to. So. And those things are important right now, the way the game's moving. If you don't have that, you're going to find it hard to stay competitive on this tour. So, like I said, you know, I'm doing most of the things. I think over the next few weeks, months, my main challenge is going to be to get back to my fitness levels or maybe even better my fitness levels to pre-COVID, get my strength and energy levels up to where they were maybe last fall when I was playing my best in the recent past, and kick on from there.
Perfect. Thanks.
Thanks, Joy.
Have fun.
I will.
Thank you, everyone.
Thanks, guys. Thanks, all of you. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Perfect. All right. Do we have one more?
One more.
Yeah.